It was David that said, I was glad when they said to me, let us go into the house of the Lord. You know, there, as Christians, we know that the church, it's the people, right? But I got news for you. The church is a building as well. And there's something that happens when the holiness of God comes into a building or comes into a person or comes into something. It just changes it. So we are on holy ground today because the Lord has been here and the Lord is here today. Let's stand up and let's give him a praise offering that he is worthy of. Come on, church. Let's bless our God. Hallelujah, Lord. You're good. You're good.
Fills the night, it cannot hide the light. Whom shall I fear? You crush the enemy underneath my feet. You are my sword and shield, though trouble lingers still. Whom shall I fear? I know who goes before me. I know who stands behind. The God of angel armies is always by my side. The one who reigns forever, he is a friend of mine. The God of angel armies is always by my side.
Come on, let's give a shout to the Lord.
Always.
church. The God over the heavens. The God who reigns over the armies of heaven. The captain of the Lord's host. The God of angel armies is always by my side. Come on, let's bless our God today. God, you're so good. You know, I notice in my life that, you know, sometimes you pray for things. Sometimes you pray a long time for things. Sometimes years, and it still doesn't happen. Or sometimes God says, no. That ever happened to anybody in here? Am I the only one? But you know what? And I'll be straight with you. Sometimes I get a little upset with God. You know, I'm just like, God, you know, what's the point of all this praying if you're not going to respond? You know, you're not going to do something. Well, first of all, he is doing something. He already has done something by sending Jesus. But I find during those times, it's because I'm looking at what I want and what I need, which is so small, really, compared to what I already have. We have so much, church. And that saying, you know, to count your blessings, we need to do that. We need to do that. We need to look and see what God has given us. And that's what this song's about. It's a new song for us. Who I was blind, now I'm seeing in color. I was dead, now I'm living forever. I had failed, but you were my redeemer. I am blessed beyond all measure. I was lost, now I'm found by the Father. I am changed from a ruin to treasure. I've been given a hope and a future. I've been blessed beyond all measure. I am counting every blessing. Counting every blessing. Counting every trusting when I cannot see. I am counting every blessing. Counting every blessing. Surely. Blessing, counting every blessing, counting every blessing. tough, Lord.
Oh, you are good to me.
Oh, when things aren't going right for me.
Oh, you are good to me.
Even when things go my way, Lord. Declare it today with our praise. You're so good, Lord.
Yes. Korea Shiroba Korea Narama Sokuriri. The Lord impressed this on me while we were praying this morning over in the cafe, and He just keeps stirring my heart to, and He says to speak it. So when Joseph was in Egypt, he was sold into slavery, and in that time, gosh, I could probably just speak for an hour right now, but in that time, God did amazing things in him. You know, we all go to that place. We've all been sold into slavery at some point in our lives, but that's where the good stuff happens. Well, fast forward, he has children, and one of his sons he names Manasseh, and that means to forget. And what it was, God was showing him prophetically that he was forgetting the father's house. He was forgetting the bad stuff that had happened to him, but the stuff that his brothers did to him, the stuff that maybe he was spoiled, whatever you believe, you know, just anything to forget the father's house. But the amazing thing is that, fast forward again, when Joshua leads them to the promised land, the place they cross over into the promised land was the land of Manasseh. So as they were crossing over into the promised land, God was saying, forget the father's house. Forgive and forget. You know, God, when we ask him to forgive us, he forgets. He puts it into the sea of forgetfulness, right? He forgets it. And because God lives in us, we have the ability to forget. We do. We don't have to believe the lie that says, well, you forgive and you have to keep forgiving and forgiving. And when you remember, which is true, but you have the ability to forget these things. We have to believe that because Christ lives in us. Who he is us. We are Christ in that sense. We have everything that he has. So this day, I feel like God is saying he's about to bring you into the promised land through Manasseh. And you're going to be able to forget the father's house. So you just pray about that and receive whatever God has for you in that. And Father, we thank you, Lord. I release forgiveness in this house. I release what you've put inside of me. And each one of us, we release you to do the work that you want to do in us. And we release forgetfulness in this place. We release the spirit of Manasseh all over the sanctuary in our own hearts, Father. Help us to forgive and to forget the Father's house, anything, God, that would hinder us, any shackles, anything, God, that would keep us from entering into the promised land that you have for us. And we thank you, Jesus. We thank you, Father, in Jesus' name. Amen.
I want to add something there. When I think of the Father's house, I always think of the Father's house. But the prophetic word today was about the pain that comes from our past and particularly our childhood. Things that happened or didn't happen, things that were spoken, things that have brought pain from your past, from your father's house, your earthly father, from the way you grew up in. And that hinders so many people from moving forward because they keep holding on to the pain of that past. And the only way that you can find true freedom is to let go of it. to let go of it, to put it under the blood, to walk away from it so that you can walk into God's very best. And we receive that word today, Lord. We receive that word today. God, that there is supernatural healing taking place in the minds and in the souls of every one of us today. If there's any residue, God, from the pain of our past that hinders us from moving forward in you, Lord God, today we receive that breakthrough, Lord. We choose to walk through Manasseh into the promised land and the promises that you have for us, for your glory in Jesus' name. Amen.
Come on, let's bless our God together. One of the things the Lord has come to do is bind up the brokenhearted. You know, you can't bind up your heart unless you give it to Him. And sometimes, you know, when we lift our hands, maybe some of you are new to that, and you're like, what's that all about? Oh, that feels kind of good. Oh, yeah, everybody else is doing it. What that is, there's a lot in doing that. It's a surrender. It's a giving of your life, a giving of your heart to the Father, to the Lord. It's kind of like saying, Papa, pick me up. You know, like your little ones used to do to you, and your mama picked me up, but it's Papa, pick me up. And that's what this song's about. Right where you are, I know we're surrounded by people, but let's just get alone with the Lord. Right where you are, surrender your heart to Him today. Lord, we give it to you, Lord. We surrender the past to you.
Here's my heart, Lord. Here's my heart, Lord. Here's my heart, Lord. Speak what is true.
Let's sing that again. Lift your hands and sing it.
Here's my heart, Lord. Here's my heart. Here's my heart, Lord. Speak what is true.
I am found. I am yours. I am loved. I'm made pure. I have life. I can.
Here's my heart, Lord.
Your love, oh Lord, it reaches to the heavens. Your faithfulness stretches to the sky. Your righteousness is like a mighty mountain. Yeah, your justice flows like the ocean's tide. Your love, oh reaches to the heaven. Your faithfulness stretches to the sky. Oh, your righteousness is like a mighty mountain. Your justice flows like the ocean's tide, and I will lift my voice to worship you, my King. And I will find my reaches to the heaven. Your faithfulness, your faithfulness stretches to the sky. Your righteousness, your righteousness, like a mighty mountain. Reaches to the heaven. Your faithfulness stretches to the sky. Your righteousness is like a mighty mountain. Justice flows like the ocean's tide. And we worship you, and we worship you, and we lift up voices, and we worship you. How beautiful.
The waters are stirred. This is the time to come and lay down your burdens, to pick up strength, to learn, draw close, gird up your loins, as I said in my word, put on your running shoes. It's time to receive what you need from me, because I'm ready to give it to you. It's time to come closer, stronger, ready for battle, spiritual, whatever it is, because I am here to give you whatever you need. I desire to equip my army, because if you're serving me, you are in a battle against the enemy of your souls and of the souls of the world. So come forward. Come to me in your hearts. Receive. Receive what you need.
Amen. Amen. He is in this place. Amen. God is good. Amen. Amen. Praise him this morning. He is the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. And we worship you, Lord. We adore you, God. We thank you for your goodness. We thank you for your love. We thank you for your righteousness. We thank you. We worship you. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Oh, God is good. God is good. God is good. Oh, he is so good and he is so faithful. Take the hand of the one you're standing next to, and we're going to believe in faith as you hold your brother and your sister. You've heard the word of the Lord. He's telling us to draw close. His Spirit is ever present this morning. His Spirit resides in each one of us. Holy Spirit, we do draw close. We ask that we hear more of you. We understand more of you. And God, you are drawing us closer to you to hear what it is that you want to say to us. Some need encouragement. Some need help financially. Some need jobs. Some need wisdom. But God, you have all the answers. Teach us as a people how to slow down and listen to you, because we get so busy, Lord, that we think we know what we're doing and we're making it harder. If we would devote more time just to sit in your presence and listen. Listen, because as you speak, you give us the answer. You provide what it is that we need. You tell us whether we should go left, whether we should go right. And Lord, we just need to listen and then simply obey you. Help us, Holy Spirit, do that. Teach us, grow us, show us, lead us. And Lord, right now, we just ask, Holy Spirit, that you bring a comfort and a peace over Philadelphia, in that entire city, that community. Lord, we don't understand this evil that's here. Well, we know what it is, but God, we rebuke it all in the name of Jesus. And we say, you send your angels now to bring comfort and peace. God, we don't get it. Oh, and our hearts just grieve for these men and women and these boys and girls in this city that are looking to you saying, why? Well, God, you use this. You use this to draw men and women towards you. You remove the blinders from their eyes as they cry out to you, that you're going to bring comfort like only you know how to do. And then, Lord, in this nation, with everything that's going on around us, Father, we need godly men and women in the White House. We need godly men and women in our local communities to raise up and to speak boldness for you and give them the courage, Lord, because they're going to be swimming upstream. So as a people, lay it on our heart to pray, what to pray, who to pray for, and how to pray. Holy Spirit, we can't do it without you. So we need you to lead us, to guide us, and to bring your comfort and your peace. Oh God, we give you all the glory, all the honor. We ask today that you be pleased. And as the word goes forth today, stir our hearts so we don't leave here the same. Jesus, we love you and we trust you. In your mighty name we pray. Everybody said, amen, amen, hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. On him in the name of the Lord. Thank you. like you. I'm a crier like you.
All right. Good morning. Now, I really hate to be the one that tries to get everybody to be quiet, because you're all having so much fun. Huh? No, I'm just saying y'all should go to lunch afterwards and chit-chat. Be nice, wouldn't it? All right. Well, welcome. We're going to do a little bit of things out of order this morning, or a little different before we receive our offering and whatnot. But we're going to share about the Dominican Republic trip, mission trip. Yeah, it was awesome. We just came back. Gosh, I guess it was a week ago. On one hand, it seems like forever, and on the other hand, it just seems like yesterday. It was amazing. We went down there as a team to work beside Pastor Rick Suker, who is one of the missionaries that we support, and it truly is amazing. Many of the team members even commented on this, but we hear missionaries that we support come and speak, or any other missionaries that we know, and it's nice, but you really can't understand it until you are there. And what he does is amazing. The churches, we went into one little pastor's church and a side trip wasn't any bigger, gosh, probably than our nursery was the size of the church with some tin roof on it. And we were told he had 10 children that are attending his church. And just a smile on his face, the pastors and the work they do. I know we do an amazing work here in our community. However, these are the unsung heroes, because nobody knows, you know, going in there twice a week and feeding these children with a little bit of macaroni and what they do. And Pastor Rick has such a heart for the men and women there. We taught in two Bible schools total, probably close to 40 students, men and women, sitting there every night. They hardly have any money to pay. And it's like $50 or something to go. It's ridiculous to us. But to them, it's like, you know, $500,000 is to us. And there they are, faithfully trusting God in the school. I'll be real quick because Pastor Nick's like, you know, time. But I just have to say, there's a lot of questions like, why? Why go? And there was Pastor Willie and his wife Isabella. And we would walk in and they would just grin ear to ear. I mean, they are in an area where they get water once a week, and they're faithfully serving. So if we can come in and bless them, hug them, touch them, and let them realize there are people that are standing beside you and praying with you. I mean, they greeted us and kissed us on the cheek because they're like, wow, you know, they were so excited to see us there and to have people pray with them. So that's where your prayers and where your support, and as a church that gives and goes to. And it truly is an honor to be a part of that. And I just can't thank you enough for your prayers and your support in sending us. So we want to share just a little bit of what we did through the week. I'm going to call the drama team up. We had 11 of us that went, 7 of which it was their first time. And the members that you're going to see in the drama team, all of them but one have, well, maybe two, have never, or three, whatever. Some of them have never been on a trip. But they practice this drama. They, you know, prior to this drama, they're not actors per se, but they did it for the Lord, and how God anointed them on the trip was amazing. And the drama depicts how we cover, and here too, we have a mask. You know, we want everybody to see a certain thing about us, but then when we're alone and that mask comes down, the brokenness in our heart, and how Jesus came to remove that mask and give us his heart. And that's what you're going to see here, that we minister to children and adults.
Thank you.
rest of the team can come on up. Amen. Wasn't that wonderful? In addition to the drama team, we had another team that put together all the bags for the children. We handed out, close to 200 bags filled with everything that was donated, toothbrushes, candy, toys, toothpaste. It was just amazing. It was just wonderful. So the team worked hard. They met, I don't know, 6-7 weeks we met, and they're probably sick of me. Anyway, we had a lot of fun, and God used each one of them. It was just truly an honor to be with them. What they're going to do now is just share about 30 seconds, a highlight from the week, and we're going to start down here with Alex, who the video that you're going to see, he put together. He was our video, He did all that stuff with the camera.
Well, I had a great mission trip. I've been on a mission trip before. I've been to Guatemala, so I had seen that kind of level of poverty, so I wasn't as shocked by that as some of the newer people. But the one thing I wasn't expecting, and it really just brought me a lot of joy, was how receptive everyone was down there. They were all just open-hearted. Nobody was turning you away. If you wanted to pray for them, you could pray for them. Most of them wanted to put a shirt on first because they wanted to be respectful, but they were just, it was fantastic, and just to see their love for God was inspiring.
The big thing for me, I think, was the prayer walk. We did a prayer walk and handed out brochures in their language. And people, like Alex said, were just so receptive and so respectful. And, you know, just you could see that they were just loving, kind people. And the women's conference on Friday night, after the conference, we lined up and they came up for prayer, and we had interpreters for us, and I just love that. Although the children are wonderful, but I just love the prayer part.
I just want to thank everybody for their support, whoever supported us financially and with the prayers. We did so much. We went to Bible schools twice, and we went to see the children several times, and they were just so happy. They have nothing, but they were so happy to see us, and they'd run up and hug you. And I just have to report that I get chronic back pain, and I didn't have any pain the entire week. And I was able to walk around and participate in everything, and I just thank everybody that was praying. Thanks.
Well, it looked like everybody stole what I was going to say already, but all I can say, it was a wonderful time. You can actually feel the presence of God there. I enjoy praying with the people, and they were definitely loving people. You could feel the love, and even with the little bit they had, they would still try to offer us stuff. You know, we're there bringing them stuff, but they're still trying to offer us stuff with the little bit they had. And the miracle we had was Johnny kept that white suit white the whole entire time.
I don't know that he's washed it yet.
This was my first missions trip, and it was wonderful. We took 11 or 12 ministry bags with us, and I thought, wow, we're taking so much stuff with us. Isn't this wonderful? But when we got there and saw the need, it was a little overwhelming because we didn't even make a dent with what we took, but which was a little hard coming back, and I was thinking, you know, how much they need, and we took some stuff, and that was nice and everything, but so as I was praying about it and kind of struggling with it, the God impressed upon me that each one of us, while there was 11 of us that went, each one of us left with a pastor, maybe a child, 2, 3, or 4, one of their wives, or somebody there in our hearts to pray for permanently, that will be permanently on our prayer list. And I thought, what we didn't do or couldn't do while we were in the short time we were there, God is going to do now that we're gone. So it's not up to us to do, you know, as much as I was hoping to do, but let God do what he needs to do. And so that's been what I've taken away from it.
I loved getting to know my brothers and sisters on this trip, and I hope and pray that I get to know everybody in this church as well. And when we gave our testimonies, our personal testimonies, it was a low point in my life. I was like 24 years old when I got saved, something that was, you know, I hit rock bottom, and Christ, you know, I reached out to God, and I got saved. And where I felt humiliated, I shared my testimony with people, and it was giving glory to God. God was glorified in that, and there's nothing better, in my opinion, than what you can do is giving your testimony and what God's done in your life.
This was my first missions trip as well. What I found was the Dominican Republic is a beautiful island with beautiful people. They just need some TLC, God's TLC. And to watch Pastor Rick and his team as they fed and ministered and loved on these kids, it's amazing. And to watch a missionary that we support, to be in his home, at his workplace, to watch him in action is just amazing. So I know what it's all about now. I've seen it from beginning to end, and that it keeps on going, that he raises up that nation to be under the blessings of God and to spread it worldwide.
So I've been to the Dominican Republic before. Back in Global, we did a mission trip there. But what was amazing to me was reliving the trip through the new people. We'd taken seven people who had never been on a mission trip before, and seeing it through their eyes and reliving my first time again through them was very rewarding to me. But my highlight of the trip would have been we were expected to share our testimonies at some point throughout the trip. We all practiced our testimonies, and we knew somewhere along the line we would be sharing our testimony. Well, on Thursday, we were ministering to a bunch of kids that age limit between 7 and 11 years old, that range of people. And Pastor Karen asked me if I would share my testimony to them. And, you know, finding a part of my testimony that would relate to them was something God and I had to work out. But that was all good. We did that. But Pastor Karen also asked me to do an altar call. And, you know, you're on a mission trip and your leader asks you to do something. The only answer is yes. So, but inside me, I'm going, I've never done this before. I have no clue what I'm doing. And so when I'm giving my testimony and I'm transitioning into the altar call, you know, I just kind of let go a little bit and let Lord just do whatever he wanted to do. And towards the end, when I was asking for a response and seeing some of the kids actually connect with what I was saying and responding, I had a half dozen kids respond. It was just very rewarding. It was over the top rewarding. Thank you.
So how do you follow up all that, right? It was my first mission trip too. Ministering to the kids was amazing. There was one night where we had a shortage of bags, and we started pulling out just the bears so we could give them to a little group of little 20 kids over here that were probably 5 and under. But you'll see on some of the pictures online, a little girl's holding those bears. Those were precious to them, and that was a beautiful thing. The women walking through the door and picking up the little crosses, the cross bookmarks, you know, and seeing them getting their name tags, and they are just looking at that cross like they've just gotten $1 million, you know. Some of the little things that nobody really noticed were amazing. This team functioned beautifully. They were a work in motion. Tina and Priscilla with drills, let me tell ya, you got whatever you need made, they're your chicks. But it wouldn't be a complete thing if we all didn't do Pastor Karen's favorite song. I've got joy, 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 joy down in my heart.
Where? Down in my heart. Where? I got the joy, joy, down in my heart. Where?
Down in my heart
to stay. Hey, I said, anybody have a song on your heart? And they just looked at me with blank eyes. So when you leave it up to me, we're bringing out my kids' songs. All right, give them a hand. They were awesome. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. So we're going to close with this videotape. Again, thank you from the bottom of our heart. We couldn't have done what we did without you. And thank you, Pastor Nick, for allowing us to share this morning.
the love of Jesus in my heart, and I'm so happy, so very happy. I have the love of Jesus in my heart.
Amen. Isn't that awesome? Just the encouragement that was just brought. Say that again, nice and loud. Amen. Praise God. I just want to encourage you. That's a good question. When are you going to go? We have three opportunities next year, at least three. Maybe God will add more. I don't know. But we're going to be going to work with missionaries that we already support. We have our trip to El Paso Juarez to visit with Mary Beth Mayfield and Gwen Conrad. That's going to be July of next year. You might be thinking Mexico's hot in July. It is. But it's dry heat. It's not humidity. I've been there in July for 2 weeks, so it's not as bad. Then we're also in October, we've got two trips planned. We've got one going to India to visit and work with the Chans. That's going to be a very small select group of people that'll go to that trip. And then we also have our Washington, D.C. trip planned, and that's going to be working with Jared and Karina Olson and Justice House of Prayer, and that's going to be a strategic prayer assignment kind of trip as well. So I want to encourage you. We're going to have a meeting in the next few weeks. I'll be watching the bulletin for that, and come on out and be a support for those things. Amen? Amen. If you didn't get a bulletin, I do want to encourage you. It's a big full one this week. A couple of important things, just to remind you, it's time to vote. Amen? It's time to vote. Paul encouraged Timothy in 2 Timothy. He says, you know, I urge then, first of all, that prayers, petitions, prayers, and intercession and thanksgiving be made for all people, for kings and all those in authority, that we may live peaceful and quiet lives in godliness and holiness. That's why righteous people need to be in powerful positions. Because the gospel can go forth when righteousness rules. Amen? So if you've been wondering who to vote for, or maybe you're making the wrong decision about who to vote for, These will help you. We have plenty of these out in the hallway and the Connect Centers. These are voting guides, and it gives you recommendations, and it tells you where each of the candidates stand on certain important issues like abortion and biblical views of marriage and things such as that. It also covers all the amendments. It covers all the judges. It covers all the House representatives, the senators. You know, a lot of things pop up when you go to the voting box and you look at those things and, like, I didn't even know, what am I supposed to do? This covers everything. So I want to encourage you to pick one of those up. And if you know someone living around Florida, you'd like to get this in their hands, you can go to our Oldsmar House of Prayer website, oldsmarhop.org, and you can click on a thing and send them a link to that. Amen? Also, don't forget that next week, or actually this coming Saturday, is our men's breakfast, so make sure you see Steve Meeker. Steve's not here this morning. See someone, let us know that you want to come to the men's breakfast, and it's going to be a good time together as we fellowship at Daddy's Grill in Oldsmar. And also, don't forget, next Saturday night, you need to fall back, right? We lose an hour's sleep. We gain an hour's sleep. I'm sorry. Someone, I don't know, maybe I'm thinking I'll just stay up an extra hour. What about this great weather we're having, huh? Isn't this awesome? I pulled up, I'm like, I see Pastor in his short sleeves. I'm like, come on, get in the spirit, man. Floridians, right? And anyway, so make sure you adjust your clock correctly next weekend so you're not, well, if you're here early for church, that's a good thing, right? You can join us for prayer at 9:15. Amen. Also coming up in just a couple weeks' time, we have the Seed Sower Workshop with Mike and Pat Dragon. How many of you came out to be a part of the workshop that they did during the Missions Conference? It was a great time. They're going to be here with us the whole weekend. Saturday from 9 a.m. until noon, they're going to be sharing on the Seed Sower Workshop is a little bit of the same thing that they did before, but then it expands. And then they're going to be ministering as well in services that weekend. So we want to make sure you're a part of that. There's other stuff that's important in there that you need to just pay attention to as well. Amen? Also, we want to give you an update. A lot of people have been asking about the churches in Africa that we gave towards last year. Remember that we sowed into those three churches in Malawi and Mozambique, along with Rev C. It was the New Year's Eve service that we gave him the check for $30,000 and sent him off to. We're like, oh, we had this picture in our mind. He's leaving for Africa tomorrow, right? That we were going to hear back on those churches. A lot of people have been wondering what's going on. Well, we have pictures for you right now that we're going to show you. And I just want to encourage you with them. So if we could pull those up. Oh, wrong way. If you remember, we sowed that $30,000, and the first two churches were in Malawi. And in Malawi, you remember Rev C said he had gone into an area that was predominantly Muslim and that he ministered and that hundreds of people got saved in that meeting. And I believe that's the testimony where one of the imams ended up getting saved as well. Well, we were able to help build a church in that community. Amen? And do we have those pictures up there? Okay, thanks. We also went into another area, you'll see in a bit here, built another church, and it was a very hard place. Matter of fact, Rev C said that the road ended about a quarter of a mile away from where the build site was, and the build site was up a very steep hill, and there was a lot of rains, which kind of held back the building of that, but you're going to see the building in just a moment. And then the third church was a surprise to us because Pastor had committed to the two churches. And you'll remember that we showed pictures just promoting what we were doing with the Boys and Girls Missionary Challenge that we're doing, collecting money with those little plastic barrels. And we showed the church that was built with sticks and visqueen, if you remember. And God laid it on someone's heart to sow towards that. And then we started giving towards that, and we were able to build that third church. Well, the money we sent down for that church, the $10,000, the church was exploding in growth. So the pastor got together with his elders, and they said, we can't fit everybody in one of these small 30 by 60 churches Rev C wants to build us. So it inspired them to commit to give as the church community. Now they're building a church that's going to hold close to 1,000 people. Amen? They're expecting that by Christmas time, they're going to have over 1,500 people in that congregation. They just had a recent evangelism effort. In one service, over 100 people gave their lives to the Lord. Praise God. Come on, let's praise the Lord for that. See, I'm just getting goosebumps. See what your giving inspired in our within the, our brothers and sisters in Christ in Mozambique to give. Well, now, as you know, that we're partnering with Wayne and Denise Deary with the Plant International. We've been challenged to give towards giving to build two churches in Tanzania, the first two churches. We actually were able to put a check in Wayne's hand this past week for $16,000 to cover the first two churches. Praise God. So the money has come in for that. He is leaving this Wednesday, and in the next 2 weeks, those two churches are going to be built. Praise God for that. So the challenge was put before us in the last month, and in 2 weeks we're gonna see pictures. So watch on Facebook, watch on the church Facebook page. We'll also bring the pictures here. Wayne is really good about posting pictures as things are happening. He'll post videos, and the Sundays that they go and they dedicate those two buildings, he's gonna post videos, and you're gonna see them greeting us as a church and thanking us as a church in their language amongst the Maasai people. Isn't that awesome? Praise God. So praise God. Now, that means, you know, if you remember, God laid it on Pastor's heart to go to give above and beyond the two that he initially felt challenged. God said, can you believe for five? And he released it to the Lord, right? And what's been awesome is now giving has come in towards a third church. We are just about $2,800. Okay, we have a little over $2,800 toward the third church. So that's $8,000 for a church in Tanzania. So that means we need $5,200 more to build a third church by the end of the year. Isn't that awesome? How many agree that's awesome? Yeah. Amen. Okay, everybody clapping if you haven't given towards that church yet. I want to encourage you. Maybe you've already given, but God's blessed you in some other way and you want to give a little more. We're going to challenge you to give before the end of the year to help give towards the final, you know, bit for that third church. And we're believing for five churches by the end of 2018. Think about that. These people have been meeting, some of them, for 10 years under a tree in the middle of a field. And now we're going to be able to put them in a building. And then the church explodes with growth as people see these buildings come as a testimony to the power of God. Amen. We also have our goal this year to raise monthly pledges for missionary support is 75 monthly pledges of $30 each. Right now we're at 51. That means we're only 24 pledges away. Now I'm going to do what Pastor does. I'm not going to ask you to bow your heads, though. I'm going to ask this. How many of you this morning would help us by saying, you know what, I can give. Maybe you did last year and you haven't renewed yet, but you'll say, Pastor Barry, I can give $30 a month towards that mission goal. We just need 24. How many would do that? Just raise your hand. Okay, there's one, two, three, four. Don't scratch your nose because I'll count it. Five. He scratched his nose. Okay. Five. You're doing three, six, seven. Come on. Anybody else? All right. So I want to encourage you, if you've made a commitment this morning, okay, that's eight. So I want to encourage you to just fill out a card and just to put your information down and just put monthly missions pledge. And maybe you didn't feel compelled to raise your hand. That's great. Feel compelled to write it down in a card and drop in the offering. Amen. Amen. I do want to encourage you this morning. I stood up here last Saturday evening, and I talked about how Tracy and I love to give, and that we're joyful in our giving when it comes to just sowing into what God's doing. Sometimes the money isn't always there, though, right? Well, you'll notice that we're only here every other Sunday, and then you'll see Pastor Karen typically the opposite weeks, and we do that so that we have coverage, pastoral coverage on Saturday night and Sunday morning with Pastor. The Sundays that Tracy and I aren't here, we typically go around and visit other churches. Sometimes we support them with worship or other things that we do because of what we do with Oldsmar House of Prayer. Well, last week we were visiting Rock Church of Tampa Bay in Oldsmar, and we were sitting in service and just enjoying the worship. My son and daughter-in-law were leading worship that morning, and came time for the offering. And I'm just feeling in my heart, I'm like, man, Lord, I just want to give something this morning. Well, a lot of you know I lost my job almost 3 months ago, my primary job, about 60% of our income. And I'm sitting there thinking, Lord, I want to give this morning, but we just don't have anything right now. So Tracy leans over to me in this moment, and she says, how much do you want to give? So I'm like, all right, she's the voice of the Holy Spirit a lot of times in my life. Amen, husbands, right? And or oh my husbands, right? And so I said, okay, and I said, well, let's give $20. Now, we didn't have any money with us. She broke out our old checkbook. Remember checkbooks? Remember those things? And she's writing out the check, and someone who was sitting behind us leaned forward and says, why do I keep hearing the word tires in my spirit when I think of you guys? And I said, well, because we've had a lot of issues with our tires. Jim, you know this. You pointed me to someone. We've had a lot of issues with our tires over the last few months, and we've gone through several used tires. We've never been able to afford to buy new tires and all. And they said, well, we're going to buy you 4 new tires this week. Amen. And I stood up here last week and even called Pastor, you know, on Sunday when we're leaving, and I'm like, Pastor, you can't outgive God. You just cannot outgive God. So even in our need, now, I haven't thought about new tires in weeks. I know we need them, but I prayed about that weeks ago, you know. Lord, provide for us. And what does God do in his timing in the moment of our need? He ministers to the need. So I want to encourage you, do not be afraid to be generous in your giving. Do not be afraid to let the Holy Spirit speak to you and say, this is what you need to do, or let your wife speak to you through the Holy Spirit, through the Holy Wife. Yeah, there you go. Amen. So it's time to take up the offering. All right, we have two cheerful givers. It's time to take up the offering. Woo! Ushers, if you prepare yourselves, amen. Oh, I also want to mention the Macaroni and Cheese Festival is going to be here next Saturday, or this coming Saturday, the 3rd of November. We're going to be here from noon until 5 o'clock. There's going to be over 3,000 people on our church campus next weekend. That means we need a lot of us here to be light and to be a presence, amen. We do have a need, and in just a moment, when they walk back that way, they'll come back up and pass out some clipboards. We want to get some people to sign up to help us out. We have needs for people to help man the information booth, and then needs for people to help watch the bounce houses for the children. Now, what happens is that they've already committed $1,000 back to the church that's going to the youth group. And then we also have these little like raffle tickets that Sherry Slayton is selling out underneath the porch. And those are $2, and it's a vote. And what it does is all that money comes to the youth ministry, but it also puts us in the vote for People's Choice for the whole festival. And then there's going to be a great big gift basket that they're going to give to us give to the winner of that. So I want to encourage you to participate in that. But when that comes around, make sure you sign up for that. Amen. Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord. Lord, we thank you that you are Jehovah Jireh. Lord, that you walk in covenant relationship with us, and you've made a promise to us by your name. You say, I am the Lord, your provider. So, Lord, I thank you for provision. I thank you that you are our source and that every good thing comes from you. Now, Lord, as we give this morning, Lord, we give cheerfully. We don't give begrudgingly, Lord God. We give, God, and we sow into what you're doing in this community through this body of believers. And we ask, Lord, that you would take this seed, that you would multiply it and make us even more effective for your kingdom. We give you glory and honor and praise. That's in your precious name we pray. And all God's people said, amen. Amen.
It's 11:24. I'm not going to worry. Do you have me turned down here? All right. There we go. Now, what about the slides? Yeah, what's happening? We're having a glitch. Jesus, heal our slides and whatever makes them happen in Jesus' name. Actually, we probably won't use most of them. Holy Spirit, you have superintended this service, and you are accomplishing what is in your heart to do. And our desire is for you to complete the good work you began when we started. And so just guide us in the remainder of our time together. And that, Lord, most importantly, you would be glorified. That you would receive the glory and the honor that you are worthy of. We love you, Lord, and we love your word. Let your word speak to us today. In Christ's name, amen. Open up to the book of Acts chapter 1. I'm going to just give you a little piece of what I had intended to share this morning, and then we'll catch up next week. Acts chapter 1 and verse 4. I've entitled the message today, The Efficacious Power of God. The Efficacious Power of God. I'll explain that in a moment for those of you who don't know what that word efficacious means. Acts 1, verse 4. Did you find it? Did you bring a Bible? Did anybody bring a Bible to church? Hold it up. Shake it around. All right. Jesus, we love your word. We're lifting it up high. Come on now, Lord. Do a quick work in us this morning. Amen? All right. I know that's your prayer for sure. Once when he was eating, Acts 1, verse 4, once when he was eating with them, he commanded them, do not leave Jerusalem until the Father sends you the gift he promised. As I told you before, John baptized with water, but in just a few days, you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit. So when the apostles were with Jesus, they kept asking him, Lord, has the time come for you to free Israel and restore our kingdom? He replied, the Father alone has the authority to set those dates and times, and they are not for you to know. But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you, and you will be my witnesses, telling people about me everywhere, in Jerusalem, throughout Judea, in Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. Last week I shared a message called The Compelling Love of God. That the love of God that the Father has for you and me compels him to do certain things. And we talked about how God's love compels him to give and to share his life and reveal himself, to bring us into intimacy, to bring joy to us, to send us to tell others and to bring us into that perfect union with him. And then when you invite Christ to come into your life, the love of the Father now dwells within you and it compels you as well. All of a sudden you find yourself wanting to do things and sharing and giving and helping others to come to know Christ. Today our focus is on the efficacious power of God. That word efficacious means having the power to produce a desired effect, an efficacious remedy. Efficacious power, power that produces a desired effect or result. In other words, it is the power of God effectively working in you to accomplish a God-given purpose. Now, if you haven't discovered this yet, there's no way that you can live this Christian life without the power of God working in your life. You can't be holy without him. You can't live a holy life without him. Without his power helping you to say no to the flesh and yes to the spirit. You need the power of God to live a life that pleases the Lord. And the power of God is found in the presence of the Holy Spirit. It is the Holy Spirit that endues us with power. But not only enduing us with power in order to live a life that pleases God, but giving us the power now to fulfill the purpose that God has for our lives. Do you know and understand that everything that Jesus did while he was in his earthly ministry here on earth, everything he did, all the signs, the wonders, the miracles, the teaching, the revelation, all of that came through the Holy Spirit in him, working through him. Acts 10:38 says, and you know that God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and with power. Then Jesus went around doing good and healing all who were oppressed by the devil, for God was with him. It was the Father who anointed Jesus with the Holy Spirit and power. And once the Spirit of God came upon Jesus during his water baptism, then Jesus was empowered to do the miraculous. And that same Spirit is resident within every believer. How many of you are believers in Jesus? You really believe him. You believe that he's God. How many of you believe that he's God? How many of you believe that he dwells within you? Yeah. That he's the only one who could save you. Amen. It's Jesus. We couldn't save ourselves. You couldn't stop doing what you were doing. You didn't, you know, so I hear some people say, oh, I've pursued God all my life. Really? You did? Well, maybe you had an interest. Maybe you even had a hunger. But you couldn't have even done that without God working in your life. You couldn't even believe unless he gave you the faith to believe. See, it starts with God, it ends with God, and in the middle it's God. It's the Holy Spirit working in us and desiring to use us. So in Luke, when Luke wrote the book of Acts, the first 12 verses in that first chapter are kind of a rehash of where he left off at the end of his gospel in the Gospel of Luke. In the Gospel of Luke, the very last thing that Jesus says before he ascends into heaven. Now, don't you know that last words are important words? Yeah, it's the last thing that Jesus said to his disciples before he departed to be with the Father. And he said to them in Luke 24:49, and now I will send the Holy Spirit just as my Father promised. Take note of that. That the Father promised, and Jesus said he would send. And he says, but stay here in the city until the Holy Spirit comes and fills you with power from heaven. And that's what we just read in the book of Acts. Now, in order to fully understand what this is about and its importance, we need to understand more about the Holy Spirit and about why Jesus told his disciples, you can't go into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature or make disciples of the nations. You can't do those things until first you are endued with power from on high, which comes in the person of the Holy Spirit, which was given by promise of the Father. So I want to give you just a little bit of background. And I'm just going to touch on a couple of things this morning, very quickly. The Gospel of John begins a discourse in chapter 13, Jesus talking to his disciples. And that discourse starts in John 13 and continues all the way through John 17. So when you read the Gospel of John, that section is an important discourse. It's Jesus preparing his disciples for his earthly departure. Understand that Jesus had walked along with these disciples and many other followers, some of them for 3 years. In John 13:1, it says, Jesus knew that his hour had come to leave this world and return to his Father. He had loved his disciples during the ministry on earth, and now he loved them to the very end. So for 3 years, he ate with them, he shared with them, encouraged them, he discipled them, he at times rebuked them, he demonstrated how to live life. These 12 men, the apostles, they left their jobs, their homes, their support in order to follow the man that they believed was the Messiah of Israel that had come to establish the kingdom of God, to rid themselves of Roman rule and to finally free Israel. That's what they believed about him. And now Jesus is with his disciples, and in just a few days, he'll go to Golgotha, and he'll be crucified on the cross. And he will leave his earthly ministry to begin his priestly ministry in heaven. And he knew that this would traumatize his disciples, his departure. Okay, just imagine yourself. You follow this person, you believe, and then all of a sudden they're gone. So he prepares them by teaching them humility and servanthood, by commanding them to love one another, and by giving them promises. First of all, he teaches them by example, humility and servanthood. Now keep in mind who he is. He is God the Creator. He is the Eternal One. He is God who was and is to come. And he left heaven and came to earth and took on an earth suit, put on a tent, and emptied himself of his divine privilege. He was still fully God, but he emptied himself, some theologians say, of his glory, some say of divine privilege, but there was a self-emptying, talks about it in Philippians 2, so that he could walk among us and reveal to us what it means to live a life that pleases the Father. And they gather together to eat. And we don't know who the first one is to walk into the room. But eventually all the disciples walk into the room. And Jesus is there. But no one performed the needed duty to wash one another's feet. This was a very practical thing. It was a needful thing. The roads in Palestine were dusty. And when people would eat, they didn't sit at nice dining room tables with big chairs and nice soft backs and all of that. No, they sat on the floor typically, and either there was a cloth on the ground or maybe sometimes a small little table, but they would recline and sit around a table. That was most typical. And so it was needful, just for sanitary sake, to wash the feet. And this was typically performed by the lowest servant in the household, if it was a large household with servants, that was typically performed by the least person. Or sometimes it was performed by the host, the owner of the home, the master of the house. And it was done in order to express his love for his guests. But on this particular day, no one would bow down and serve the other. And so Jesus takes a cloth, a towel, and a basin, and he goes around and he washes his disciples' feet. Peter objected to it and said, "Oh, you'll never wash my feet." And Jesus said, "If I don't wash your feet, you'll have no part of me." And then you remember Peter. Well, then just give me a bath, Lord. Just, you know, I'll take all of it. And Jesus says to them in John 13:13, "You call me teacher and Lord, and you are right, because that's what I am. And since I, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you ought to wash each other's feet. I've given you an example to follow. Do as I have done to you. I tell you the truth, slaves are not greater than their master, nor is the messenger more important than the one who sends the message. Now that you know these things, God will bless you for doing them." Understand here that Jesus was not creating another religious ceremony for the church. This was not a ceremonial deal here. This was a practical need, and what Jesus was demonstrating to his disciples was that it's important for you to be willing to bow down to others in humility, to serve them, and in practical ways, to take care of practical needs. See, if you want the power of God to flow in and through your life, it is best expressed through humility. People love position and power. Amen? Yeah. Your love position. You like to be recognized. I guess I'm talking in tongues. Let me give the interpretation. You love power, don't you? Yeah, you do. You love power. You love position. You say, oh, not me, Pastor. No. I'm humble. I wrote a book about it. You know, humility is the ability to do something that you feel might be below you that will help lift someone else up. Humility is when you serve and you don't need the accolades. You don't need an attaboy. You don't need somebody to recognize that you've served. Humility goes against our human nature, doesn't it? Because aren't we prideful? Yeah, we are. Pride is self-seeking, self-centeredness. Pride is self-elevation. Who would be the one to stoop down? It was Jesus who did it. And the question for you now is, do you have the master's heart? What are you willing to do? What are you not willing to do? Will you stoop down and serve? Will you help? Will you care? Next weekend, next Saturday, we'll have somewhere between 1,000 and 3,000 people coming to the church grounds here for the God-ordained macaroni and cheese fall festival. When they called me up and said, would you be willing to host a macaroni and cheese fall festival, I said, I didn't even have to pray about it. I said, that has to be Jesus. That has to be Jesus. What a gift. Macaroni and cheese festival? Celebrating macaroni and cheese? Even if it was just macaroni I was in. They had me at macaroni. And we had, we've done it for 2 years. First year, we had probably close to 2,000 that first year, my estimate. Last year was a little bit less. This year, the people who coordinate this event are just, I mean, they're blowing it up. I mean, there's all kinds of food trucks going to be here. People are buying tickets online for some of the kids' events, the, you know, pony rides and whatever else, petting zoo and the bounce house and all that kind of stuff. We're going to have a tent here, and in the tent, we're going to be giving away the Jesus film. We got 2,000 Jesus films given to us. Yeah, so we're going to give the Jesus film out to people, and we're going to engage people, and we need people to do that. We need people by the bounce house to watch the bounce house. And, you know, it's an opportunity to be a light to our community that God brings to our community. But it'll take humility. It'll take a willingness to say no to what might be better to do. You know, Pastor, I'm going on my boat next weekend. Pastor, I'm golfing. Pastor, my underwater basket weaving class meets on Saturday mornings. But there's going to be potentially 3,000 people here who we might be able to plant a seed and touch or pray with and see a miracle happen. And it's going to take the village here. We need all of us to help out. You see Sherry after church today out at the outside there in the portico, and she'll help you get registered. Jesus taught by humility, the importance of humility. Just one more thing. Jesus prepares his disciples for his departure with a new commandment, John 13:34. So now I am giving you a new commandment. Love each other. And here's how. Just as I have loved you, you should love each other. Your love for one another will prove to the world that you are my disciples. The acid test of discipleship. How will people know you are an authentic follower of Jesus? By your love for one another. I love, this happened yesterday too. There was a musical interlude right when I talked about love. See, we have these things prearranged. You know, we're a high-tech church. I find it interesting that love is commanded, that we are commanded to love, that Jesus just doesn't suggest it. It's commanded. It must be because it doesn't come naturally. It must be that it's not in our nature to love, particularly unconditionally, like Jesus. See, Jesus loves unconditionally. Aren't you glad he loves you unconditionally? Because, you know, we'd flunk out. If he put all kinds of conditions on her, but he loved unconditionally. I'm glad he loved me unconditionally, because once I received the love of God, once I experienced that love, it now freed me to be able to love him back. And so then he goes on to say, now, a new command I give you, love one another. It's commanded. So therefore, it is possible. God would never command you to do something that he would not first enable you to do. But it doesn't come naturally. That's right. It comes supernaturally. It comes through the power of the presence of the Holy Spirit in you that can help you to love the unlovely. To help you to love the unlovable person that you're sitting near or around or is somewhere in this church. You say, oh, come on, Pastor. We're all Christians. We're brothers and sisters. Yeah, you fight like cats and dogs sometimes. Sometimes you're just mean-spirited. Just say, oh, me. Oh, me. That's right. Yeah. We get on each other's nerves, Kathy, sometimes. It just happens. Okay. I irritate you. You irritate me. We rub against each other. The iron sharpening iron doesn't feel like a God thing at times. Right? Right? Don't we irritate one another? Just say, yes, we do.
Yes.
Yeah. No, say it this way. Yes, I do. I do it. I irritate people. That's right. And if you didn't say it, you just irritated me. See, this capacity to love, this command to love, is the key to letting the world know that there is a God in heaven and he also dwells within you and me. Because the world puts all kinds of conditions on love. You have to act a certain way. You have to do a certain thing. You've got to be a certain person. You've got to have a certain pedigree. There are certain things that I can't love you if you don't measure up to some standard that's in my mind. But God wants us to love like he loved, because he wants his love to flood the hearts of people, because that's what changes a heart. Yeah. It's that love of God, that unconditional love of God. And he commands us to love, and therefore he gives us the power to love. If he puts the expectation, he would never put an expectation on you that you had no ability to fulfill. That would be most cruel. It would be very cruel to put an expectation on your son or daughter that they didn't have the physical, the mental, or the emotional capacity to fulfill. But God gives us the capacity, and it's through the indwelling of the Holy Spirit in our lives that will help us to love like he loves. And when people see us loving each other, when they see the demonstration of that love, the reality of that love, as we come alongside and help a brother in need, help a sister in need, as we have conflict with one another, and we're going to have conflict. We are, because, you know, we have different perspectives and different things that happen. Listen, unity is not about everybody thinks exactly the same way and believes everything exactly the same way. That's not unity, because there can be differing opinions, but we don't elevate our differences. We find our commonality in the love of God for us and what Jesus did for us, and in our common goal to bring that love to a world in need around us in the community and in the nations. I was sitting here yesterday before the memorial service for Bob and Sandy. What a beautiful celebration of life we had yesterday of these two precious people, who husband and wife, who died within 23 days of each other. Yeah, you imagine the impact on their family. Pray for the Bowman family, their sons, their children and grandchildren and great-grandchildren. But I was sitting here, and Pastor Barry had sent me the slides of the churches that you didn't see this morning. You'll see them next week. But I was looking at this, and I was overwhelmed. I literally came to tears as I was sitting here just by myself, looking at what God is doing in us and through us. How the impact that we're having on the world. Do you realize that those buildings that are being built are going to speak to that region, not just the village, but the region beyond it? It's going to attract people to it. People are going to be saved for all of eternity. And the ripple effect others go from that village to other villages and share the love of Jesus with people. And in 2 years now, five churches that we've helped to establish, and maybe more before the end of the year, God give us the grace. But that's the love of God working in us, because see, when his love is working in you, it compels you to give. And you just release the blessing because you want to see others know the blessing and that flow that comes. The love of God, the command to love, it heals, it helps, it lifts people up, it changes things. And he commands us to, and you have the capacity to love like God loves when the Spirit of God dwells within you. And the closer and more intimate you are with Jesus, the greater capacity you have to love like him. Exactly. And the opposite is also true. The more shallow your relationship is with God, if you're just a weekend fan, but not a daily follower, if you have no prayer life, if you don't read your Bible, if you don't pray and just spend some time with Jesus, then your capacity to love like him will be greatly diminished. So, we're talking about the efficacious power of God. We're talking about the power of God and the necessity for that power to be working in us and through us. And it starts with humility. As you bow low to serve others, God empowers you. And then the command to love. Listen, his power without love is dangerous. If there's no love behind the power, then it can become dangerous. God is doing something really wonderful here at New Hope Church. Not just here, in a lot of places. And we've seen the Lord do some amazing things here just you know, through our mission weekend and things that are happening and through the year, God's blessing and done some things. This next step about understanding the Holy Spirit and His presence and power working through our lives is going to elevate us another step up. God wants us all to be baptized with His Spirit and life so that the power of God can be released to do the work that He's called us to do and live the life that pleases Him. All right, we're going to bow and close here in a word of prayer. Precious Lord, Jesus, do what only You can do, God. Lord, earlier today we sensed by Your Spirit a healing presence here to heal brokenness in people's lives, to heal wounds from the past, God. Saturate every soul, God, with that healing virtue, to heal the wounds of the past. That love, let it fill every breach, God, and heal. And Lord, guide us down the path of humility and love so that we could do what You've called us to do. Thank You, precious Jesus, for Your love. Thank You for Your love, Jesus. In the quietness of this moment, I just want to take a moment. Is there anyone here and you'd say, Pastor, I don't know that I'm ready. If today were my last day, I don't know that I'm ready to meet God. I don't have that quiet confidence in my heart that I would be accepted into God's heaven. Maybe you know about God, but you just don't have that intimate relationship with Him and that peace that comes when you know that everything's right between you and God. And if you're here today and you'd say, Pastor, pray for me. I need Jesus. I want to ask Jesus to be my Lord and Savior. I want to turn my life over to Him. And you'd lift a hand. I want to pray for you. Is there anyone here and you'd say, pray for me? Come on, do it quickly. Is there anyone here and you'd say, pray for me? I need You, Jesus. Would you say to me today, Pastor, I've been distant. And today I just want to draw near. I want to rededicate my life to Him. I want to surrender once again. I've been following at a distance, but I want to draw close. And you'd lift a hand. I'll pray for you. Is there anyone here? And you'd say, pray for me. I just need to rededicate my life to Christ. Bless you. Father, You know every heart in this room, every person. You know where we are with You. And I pray, Lord, that for the one who raised their hand, and maybe there are others here, God, who didn't raise a hand, but they know things just aren't quite right between You and them. Father, draw them near. Open up the eyes of their understanding. Give them revelation of Your great love and draw them to that love to receive it. Thank You, God. Thank You for Your amazing grace and the power of Your love that transforms our lives. Be honored and glorified, God, in and through us, even this week, God. Be honored and glorified. Wherever we go, help us to be conduits of Your love to the world around us. In Christ's name, amen. I pray God's peace and grace cover and keep you till we gather again. Go till we meet again next week. Elders, come on, if you need prayer, our elders are here to minister to you. God bless you. We'll see you next time.